Good morning, and thank you for joining us in the virtual format that you are joining us. My name is Kelvin Goertzen, Manitoba's Minister of Education, joined here this morning by Manitoba's Deputy Minister of Education, Dana Rudy, and I thank her and our staff in the department for the work that they're doing. Since March, of course, and the disruption of learning in schools, there's been a great deal of work that's been happening in terms of moving to a more virtual format of education. And I know that in spring, that was difficult for many students and particularly for teachers as well. That has been a challenge. But through the spring and then leading into the summer, lots of work to develop our virtual learning environment, InformNet, which is essentially the provincial online high school housed in Winnipeg School Division, has been expanded. It was expanded for summer school throughout the summer to help those who needed the additional access to the online high school. And I think at this point it's running at about five times the capacity that it was previous to the pandemic. And so that work has continued. But we also know in particular that this has been a challenging time for parents, for teachers, for all those who are working in the school system, as there's been disruption, as one would expect, during the pandemic. Of course, we also saw at the beginning of the school year, many parents opt to homeschool their children who otherwise might not have opted to homeschool, but did so because of the pandemic environment. And so there are many more students now who are learning at home for a variety of different reasons. And yet, I want to emphasize that, and it's important to always emphasize, that those who are working in our school system, teachers, EAs, the bus drivers, janitors, everyone who's involved in the school system, this is a stressful time. And they are in a stressful situation, as much of society is. But they're doing a tremendous job. And that's confirmed by Dr. Rusin in Public Health when he states often that the transmission rates in school compared to society generally has been relatively low. And that's a direct credit to those who are working in our school environment. And they deserve the credit for ensuring that students are remaining safe in this very difficult time of the pandemic and where we are now. School divisions were advised before the school year began that they were being provided $100 million, both with the savings that they had accrued and provincial support that they could use that for a variety of different things, including staff. My understanding, our most recent report indicates that about 500 teachers have been hired since March in support of that and using those funds that were made available. And then in addition to those 400 teachers, there will be many more support staff that have been hired as well. Now, the teachers are generally, of course, hired by the school divisions. They are employees of the school division. Today, we are announcing, however, that the province, in coordination with our partners, will be hiring at least 100 teachers and 20 EAs in the development of a remote learning unit. Now, this work began several weeks ago. A consultant has been working over the last many weeks in the development of this remote learning support center. And the work that has been happening up until now allows us to begin the populating of it with at least 100 teachers and the 20 EAs, in addition to support from the various divisions. And that team has been coming together over the last little while as well. So this support, this hiring of 100 teachers and EAs, will help the teachers who are delivering education remotely It'll be a team that will assist those to benefit those who are homeschooling and for those who are providing remote learning. Also want to indicate that we are going to be adding three additional professional development days. These are non-instructional days to be added to the school calendar for the 2021 school year. We are asking that at least two of those days be allocated for before the Christmas break. This will help to assist teachers in collaborative efforts to both assess in terms of how things have been going so far, learning strategies, how they can continue to look forward and to work with the remote learning center as well. So those three additional professional development days will be added to the school calendar. Again, two of which we're asking they be put into the calendar before Christmas at the discretion in terms of timing of the school divisions. I recognize that school divisions themselves have been moving some professional development, non-instructional days into their own calendars. And so we want to give them that flexibility to add these additional two in the way that works best for their individual school divisions. So again, before I take your questions, I think it's important to note this is a difficult time of the pandemic that we're in now. Everybody understands that in every part of society, whether you're in the schools, whether you're in healthcare field, whether you're in the service industry, everybody is going through a very, very difficult and challenging time right now. And we want to say, as a parent myself, but I know that I would echo this on behalf of all parents in Manitoba, we're very appreciative of those who are working in our school system. You've had to change and you've had to adapt, and sometimes you've had to do it more quickly than you would like, and we know that. But the evidence is, and it's been echoed by Dr. Rudy, is that your work and your effort has made schools comparatively safe than many other places because you're making that effort and you're implementing those protocols that have been put forward by public health. So thank you again. We obviously hope that the additional hiring of these 100 teachers will help the students and to help parents and teachers as they're engaged in this remote learning. So with that, Deputy Minister Rudy and I are looking forward to the questions that you might have on the line.
Thank you, Minister. A reminder to our reporters on the line, you will have one preliminary and two follow-up questions this morning. Up first from CTV Winnipeg, Jeff.
Oh, hi. Could you just explain from this remote learning, this dedicated unit, will it be to assist the teachers who will already do the remote learning, or could they be doing some of the remote learning on their own? Which grades and that? Like, I'm just trying to wrap my head around it.
Yeah, thanks very much, Jeff. So, I mean, Dana will want to speak to this as well, I'm sure, but it's certainly going to, you know, be supportive of those teachers who are doing remote learning now within the system. It'll be supportive of the students who are at home now with remote learning. It'll be a helpline and a help center that'll be set up. Also importantly, they'll be developing a lot of resources. So resources that'll be available in terms of material that can be provided to those students who are doing at-home learning so that it's not, you know, incumbent always upon the teachers to be developing that when they're doing other things within their classrooms. And these modules and at-home learning resources will be important for those who are at-home learning now, but also for teachers who are in the classroom and doing both models. Dana.
Yeah, and I'll just add that so far the focus right now is on building a repository of learning and assessment materials that supports teachers across the province. Our focus is on K-8 at this point in time, but we will be also recognizing that professional learning and development will be a core element of supporting our teachers. And so that would be for K-12 teachers as well. There also includes a focus around what kind of support students may need as a result of learning from home, and additional supports targeted towards parents, even in terms of a help desk where parents can receive some additional information and supports around remote learning.
My next question, Minister Goertzen, we're just hearing reports about school division, schools dealing with expired masks. Can you shed any light on that? Where did they come from, and what have you learned?
Yeah, thanks for the question, Jeff. So on the weekend, we started to hear the sort of significant reports of this, and under the direction of our deputy minister, direction was given to school divisions to set aside those masks that are within question. And then we've had contact with the Department of Central Services, which is responsible for the purchasing of PPE generally in the province. And so I believe that they are doing an investigation into those masks to determine what challenges there are with them, if any. So they are going to be reporting back in terms of what they have discovered. But we did have discussions with the school divisions and direction on the weekend to set those masks aside. And then the Department of Central Services, which does the purchasing and distribution of PPE, are doing their investigation and will be reporting back to us as well. Dana, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
Do I get another follow-up? Sorry, I don't know the format.
Yes.
Oh, okay. I do have another one. Minister Goertzen, I'd also like you to respond to this teachers and educators letter today. You're announcing $10 million today. They're still calling for a lot more. And in all of that, you're announcing this remote learning today. Is there a plan to go full remote learning, even if we're not in code red?
So we'll continue. Thanks, Jeff, for the three questions. I mean, we'll continue to follow the advice of public health, and what we continue to hear from public health and Dr. Rusin isn't that there aren't challenges within the school system. There are, and isn't that there aren't stresses on those who are working in the system, because there are, as there are stresses, it seemingly everywhere is in society these days. But the evidence is, from a public health perspective, is that the rate of transmission within our schools is comparatively low compared to other places in society, and that that the schools continue to be a safe place for students to be. There are, of course, now more options, and under the different code levels we're at, school divisions are able to offer those more robust at-home and remote learning options. We are seeing some uptake of that. In some school divisions, it might be in some schools, it might be as high as 20%. In others, it's much smaller. But that still means that the vast majority of parents have confidence within the school system as well. But I know that that's a difficult question, because, I will certainly hear from some who feel that the school system should be closed, and I hear from many others who are very grateful that their children are able to go to school. So that isn't there isn't uniformity in terms of how people feel about that, and maybe we're in a time right now where there isn't going to be uniformity on anything that people feel. However, we continue to follow that public health advice that what's happening in our schools in terms of that rate of transmission, even though cases show up in the school because there are cases in community, but the rate of transmission is comparatively low, which is a direct credit to teachers, EAs, bus drivers, janitors, those who are working under difficult circumstances but are clearly having a positive effect.
From City News, Stephanie.
Hi, Minister Goertzen. Stephanie Lasuk with City News. I just wanted to throw a scenario at you. So some early educators say that they're running between classrooms to provide learning for their students. I just wondered if you could tell me how this new remote learning center will help those teachers in particular.
So obviously, in terms of how those classes are structured, they're happening at the school division level. The operational aspect of this is happening with school divisions and the work that they're doing. And I know it's not the same in every school division, that some of them are doing things a little bit differently. But this support will be there to, you know, to help and to assist those teachers who are doing remote learning. There'll be more resources that are available in terms of material. But it's difficult for me to sort of speculate at an operational level what's happening in every school division and how this particularly will impact, one aspect of an operation in a school division compared to another.
Okay, so let me throw out a different scenario then. What about for high school? I believe you guys just said this is focused on K-8 for now. The high school students or the high school teachers are the ones largely doing the blended learning. How will this benefit them?
So, I mean, all of the teachers within the school system will have the opportunity to, access the resources that are developed by the remote learning resource center. And so that benefit will be there for them. But I don't want to, say, Stephanie, that, anything that is announced today or anything that is announced in the weeks to come is going to make the school environment the same as it was last September. I cannot say, and I don't think anybody in any level of government can say, that things are going to be as they were, anytime soon. Now, this is going to be a challenging time, and these resources, I think, are going to benefit and are going to help. But it would be wrong for me to say that even with this support or future support or any other support, that things are going to be the same as they were in September. This is of last year. This is going to be a challenge. We're providing resources and we'll continue to provide resources to try to alleviate what are very, very stressful and difficult circumstances. But we know that we're going to be in this pandemic for a while yet, and the challenges are going to continue for a while yet, but we want to make sure that we are, providing these resources to benefit and to make it a little bit less challenging. But that doesn't mean it won't be challenging.
And how did the province come to this idea of a remote learning center when other teachers have asked and advocates have asked for just maybe more substitute teachers or more teachers hired within their school divisions?
So as I mentioned at the beginning, from our understanding, since March, there's been about 400 additional teachers that have been hired across the system, and that doesn't include other support staff. So that would just be teachers, and that is because of the funding that's been made available. My understanding right now in terms of the expenditure levels that have been happening is that we would expect that through this school year there'll be, at least $180 million of additional expenditures specifically related to the pandemic, and that includes the hiring of staff. So that hiring of staff, has been happening significantly. The expenditures will continue to happen significantly. This initiative today is supported by the federal funds that have been provided. But certainly what I'm seeing in terms of the expenditures that have happened until now is that the combination of the savings from the school divisions combined with the money that was committed to by the province plus the federal money that was announced is going to be fully expended through this school year, and maybe even beyond that, beyond the expenditure. And that's the reality of where we're in. But there has been significant hiring of teachers long before this announcement today. This is specifically, though, about helping for those students who are at the remote learning, and then also, of course, helping the teachers who are at as well.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Maggie.
Hi, Minister Goertzen. I was just wondering if there's an update on rapid testing for teachers. I know this is something that the Premier had mentioned last week was quite important, and it was also in that letter that was sent out to yourself on behalf of those teachers today.
Yeah, I mean, it is a priority for us as well. We'd obviously like to see rapid testing for teachers, as the Premier mentioned last week. They're working with the federal government to ensure that we can get that level of rapid testing and then deploy it into those areas where it's most critical. Clearly, that's a factor within the healthcare system as well. But there is support, you know, within in the government level to have rapid testing within the school system and for teachers and others. But it is a function, of course, of making sure that we can get enough of those tests and then determining where the need is the greatest.
Okay. And Minister, again, in terms of this remote learning setup, from what I understand, so it's essentially a help center that's going to provide teachers with resources, correct?
It is certainly going to help. It is going to provide teachers resources and to ensure that those teachers who are working and doing remote learning can have that additional support, both in terms of resources and the instructors. Dana, do you want to speak to
that? Yeah, so, and the Remote Learning Support Center has a focus on building up a repository of learning and assessment materials, as I've mentioned before, but also enhancing professional learning and creating a hub to support teachers. And that would include instructional coaching, opportunities for supporting on the job as well as remotely. And then a help desk is intended to assist with those technology problems. So if a parent or a teacher is having challenges with logging into a system or understanding how to leverage different platforms that the school divisions have invested in, then they can use those they can use that help desk for that support as well. So it's a little bit more than just a simple help desk. It will have a whole host of options available to support teachers and students over the course of the year.
Okay. We knew that this was likely going to be a possibility going into September, so I'm curious why it took so long. I mean, now it's November 9th that you guys are launching this. What's with the delay there?
So this started, thanks very much again for the question, Maggie. This started, weeks ago in terms of the planning. As I mentioned, a consultant has been working on this now for a while. The hiring of the teachers, sort of the population of teachers and EAs within to the system isn't the first step. It's much closer to the last step. So that work has been ongoing, along with other sort of remote learning avenues and FormNet we've talked about before and you've reported on in your publication before. So there's been a number of different things that have been happening when it comes to remote learning, and this is this isn't the beginning of this particular initiative. But before we sort of put out the advertisement for teachers, which I think is going out now or almost before the end of the day, that work had to happen first. So the foundational work has already been happening for weeks.
From Global, Malika.
Well, I just wanted to ask, so kind of just alluded to that, my question is, when is this going to start? When is this new resource center going to be ready to roll out?
So our expectation is that it would be happening this month, again, because much of the preparatory work has already happened. But Dana, do you want to provide more details?
Yeah, I mean, it's already actively underway. So we have several school divisions that have been partnering with the province on the launch of it. And this will be incremental. We'll be building it over time because we know that we're in the long game at this point with the pandemic. And so as new and additional supports and opportunities are developed, those will be added in as part of the Remote Learning Center. And it just really does augment and build upon all the important work that teachers and school divisions have already undertaken. And so this is intended to really be a repository that all teachers from across the province can access to ensure equity of access for everyone.
Okay, that's wonderful that you said you had been working alongside other school divisions. How many school divisions, that was my next question, have you consulted Manitoba teachers about this new resource center? Is this something that they wanted?
Yeah, so we've been working with several different school divisions with a steering committee and an advisory council. We have representatives from school divisions in Winnipeg, in rural areas, as well as northern areas. Our work has started with the consultations with superintendents last week, and we'll start to move out towards further building of those supports with teachers and principals and other education stakeholders over the next week or two. So I wouldn't say it's necessarily that it's something that we're putting on top of the system, but rather trying to leverage all of the great work that's already been established. So teachers have, been asking for supports as it relates to remote learning. And so we're hearing that in partnering with the school divisions.
Okay, perfect. And my last question, the 100 teachers and the 20 EAs, they are just going to be solely for this resource center, is that correct? And then people, like you said, there's going to be a call center for parents if they need help with logging on or whatever, but that's like the 120 staff plus IT members are going to be running this resource center for the province. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. And then we'll also have a support team that's comprised of some representatives from school divisions as well that are already building the repository and the online portal.
And it's important to remember that while generally, and I've said it before, generally it's the school divisions that are the employers, the direct employers of teachers, and they've been hiring more staff since March using the funding that's been made available, and they'll continue to be made available. This is, you know, somewhat more unusual because the province is doing this direct hiring in coordination with, I believe it's the St. James School Division.
Thank you.
From CJOB, Amber.
Hi. Was this being set up in case schools needed to shut down again, or is this just kind of here as a supplementary program?
Yeah, it is as a supplementary program. Obviously, all of us hope in the entire, you know, system in terms of cohorting and other things that was designed together with public health through the summer and leading up to the reopening of the schools was designed to keep schools open. Now, obviously, we're through a pretty going through a pretty tough time right now in the pandemic in terms of the rate of cases and the rate of transmission. But still, with even within that right now, our indications from public health is that the rate of transmission in schools is low. So it's not a preparatory work for schools not staying open. It is still obviously, I think, all of our goal to ensure that schools can remain open so long as it's determined by health officials that it's both safe and proper to do so.
And I guess, like, just so I can kind of understand what this is, would this be like online lectures, or would this be like every grade 8 student would have access to the same type of resources across the province, or is this very specific resources for very specific classes?
Yeah, and I would say that teachers already are experts in terms of developing content and teaching and have a wealth of experience with the resources that are available to them. This remote learning support center is intended to create a repository so that they can access additional supports and materials as they try to convert their classrooms from in-person to online. And so the methods and pedagogy that teachers use with their students when they're in a remote situation are different. And so that this support center is intended to acknowledge that difference. But in addition to the actual remote learning materials, there's also the intention is to build skills and develop and support teachers as they embark on additional and ongoing remote learning and sustaining that over the whole year.
Okay, my last follow-up question is, I'm not sure if you guys saw the open letter from a group of teachers and educators outlining a number of complaints that they have. One of those complaints is contact tracing being slow in schools, and they're saying that principals are having to kind of take this on their own to kind of make sure that students are informed, because it's just such a slow process and they're being informed too late. Can you speak to that, Minister, about just how this process is being slow and how this is kind of being additionally put on the schools themselves?
So the contact tracing, of course, is more a function of public health, and the notification comes through public health when we get notified. And so, you know, some of that you might want to direct to public health or Dr. Rusin when the next media availability is for him, which I think is actually this afternoon. But, you know, obviously, you know, we've said to schools where there is information that they have, where principals have information that they have, and they feel it is important to provide that information to their school community, they have the ability to do that. recognizing that it's a difficult time for public health as well as they're dealing with the volume of cases that we're seeing. Clearly, we hope that measures that are being put in place will see those numbers come down, and measures that, that people themselves take to bring those numbers down. That will obviously assist in that, but we're not prohibiting principals and others of providing information that they feel is important to their school community if they have that information.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Scott.
Hello, good morning to you both. Scott Bill, Winnipeg Sun. Kind of piggybacking on that question, have schools been instructed not to report? If a case has happened and 48 hours have passed since that case has happened, and contact tracing hasn't been reported and all that, have schools been instructed just not to report that?
No. So what we've done is we've worked with our school division superintendents and also the principals of independent schools to give that discretion to the principals of schools in consultation with their administrators, that if they hear of cases within their school community, whether that's students or teachers, that they have the ability to act as they see fit. They can reach out to the department, to Manitoba Education, and we try to expedite any contact that is required. Public health is prioritizing all cases for cases in schools because they recognize the importance of those conversations. So once a school is identified as part of the contact tracing, the medical officers of health are quick to intervene and provide support. So it's that interim period of time where that contact tracing has not yet been done and principals may become aware. And so we've really encouraged that. Principals know their school communities and vice principals. They've been here since the beginning of reopening of schools, and they're handling it with exceptional professionalism. And we're finding that when they do get in touch with public health, they're very supportive of those relationships. But certainly our principals are really the driving force behind making sure that schools are safe.
Thanks for that. My first follow-up is the Pembina Valley School Division recalled the masks in question on October 28th. Why is government only finding about this now, since it's been, you know, I guess 2 weeks since that happened?
So, I mean, I'd have to get some of the more information from Central Services. They are now, I understand, looking into, you know, whether or not the masks have challenges or problems. And they're going to report back to us. I mean, we did obviously now over the weekend when we saw that sort of significant concern raised publicly, asked them to put the masks aside. But we have to let Central Services do that sort of investigation on whether or not the masks themselves are problematic, and if so, how that came to be.
Okay, and then my final follow-up. In that letter today sent, the teachers are asking for more resources. Obviously, this is more resources, but not more teachers in the actual system, in school divisions, that sort of thing. Seven Oaks reported last week, Seven Oaks School Division, they issued a directive, to their staff saying that, they need to look for substitutes internally, that the substitute pool has been depleted. What is being done about that? These teachers are talking about an imminent collapse to the public school system. When you hear that, I mean, what is the reaction to that? These are your teachers asking these, or bringing this to your attention.
Yeah, look, again, I don't dismiss the fact, and I don't think anybody should, that this is a very challenging time everywhere is in society. In our schools, absolutely. In the healthcare field, absolutely. In the service sector, yes. In every part of society, there are very, very difficult and challenging times. And so, when we hear those concerns from the school system, absolutely, it concerns us. This announcement today, isn't a reaction to that. It's being planned for a while. But it is a recognition that this was going to be a difficult school year. And I think all of us understood it was going to be a difficult school year. School divisions, you know, have been hiring teachers and can continue to hire support. As I mentioned earlier, we expect that there'll be at least $180 million of additional expenditures through this school year, and that the totality of the funding that is being provided by the province and the federal government is going to be fully expended and maybe beyond that. We just know that that is going to be the issue. But the school divisions are generally sort of the direct employers of teachers. This is a bit of an exception where the province is more involved in that. But they certainly have that ability, and they've been exercising that ability on the hiring.
From CBC Manitoba, Holly.
Hi, Holly Carrick with CBC. So I heard from a lot of teachers just the sheer fact of handling remote learning and in-class learning was something that was very stressful and often not achievable. Now, I just want to be clear, is this resource is not taking remote learning off of those teachers' plates, it's just giving them a resource that will help them with that task.
Right. It'll provide support to those who are both engaged, but then also on the receiving end of remote learning.
So then I have to go back to the letter, like the teachers saying, like, these are unsustainable workloads for them to have to be in more than one classroom at once and worry about kids trying to do remote learning from home. Letter listed a number of other things, but what is going to be done to address those other issues?
So again, you know, working with the school divisions, there are resources in place for hiring of teachers and for staff at the school division level. And I believe all of them have exercised that. We are always in communication with school divisions on, you know, our regular calls to try to address the different challenges that they have. And some express different challenges than others. They're not exactly all the same because they're operating their own division sometimes differently. So we don't always hear the exact same concerns from the individual divisions, but they have been hiring teachers since March and will continue to be in coordination and discussion with those divisions where they're expressing specific and particular concerns.
Okay, and going back to the masks, I mean, we've heard that some of these masks in question could be around 10 years old. How old is the stock of PPE that schools are being given?
So we don't procure or purchase the masks. Those are being done through central services. So I can't give you an answer in terms of you know, what's happening in that that portion of government. But they are investigating it, and I don't think we should jump to one conclusion or the other. Whether or not, you know, what's being speculated about is true or isn't true. I think we need to let them do that that investigation and to look into the mass. And I understand from a call that our department had this morning with them that that's exactly what they're doing. They're undertaking that right now. But in the meantime, so to not wait for the investigation to be done, they are, we asked that those masks be put aside on the weekend, not to be used, and to allow the purchasing agent to do that investigation.
From the Canadian Press, Steve.
Minister Goertzen, I'm going to reference the letter today as well. The workload for teachers here seems to be from having to perform both in-class learning and remote learning, many teachers in that scenario. Can you commit to throwing in more resources so that either classroom numbers are shrunk or that they have some way to reduce that workload?
So, Steve, you know, again, the school divisions, you know, are operating their systems there. They're not all doing it exactly the same way, and we hear different reports from different school divisions about what their individual challenges are. I mean, we work with them daily to try to address some of that. There has been resources made available. Those resources are all going to be likely expended. We're certainly on track to expend the entire amount of the resources. And if there are more needed, then that will be addressed. But the individual operational level is done by the school divisions, and they are provided those resources to try to address those needs that they have. But we don't hear the same things from every place.
Yeah, and I'll just add, because obviously our planning within Manitoba has really been a strong focus on in-class learning to the greatest extent possible. But we also know that we're living in a pandemic, and so students find themselves in remote learning situations either because they have a medical accommodation, or they are close contacts or a case themselves, whether it's a household member or themselves. And so we've recognized that teachers want to continue that learning for those students so that they don't lose out on learning while they're isolating at home. And so we're talking about those kids too at this point. And we know that as the cases increase within the community, those kids also will find themselves at home and in need of remote learning. And so this support center is intended to be to augment and support those teachers that find themselves in that situation. So it's not necessarily that a student has been enrolled in remote learning and in class, but rather that continuity of learning that depending on the circumstances of that individual family or student, they will know that the teacher will be there to provide support until they can return to the classroom.
And in terms of, you know, my question was regarding blended learning too, which involves some online learning, and teachers say their workload is such because they have to do both. They were doing in class, now they're doing in class and some remote, not in school learning. And I think school divisions would welcome more money, Minister. So you said if there's a need, then it will be addressed. Do you not see a need right now for more money other than what has been budgeted?
So that support level is there in terms of the funding, and we provided that information to the school divisions, you know, early on. They've gone about and have been doing hiring, I believe, already, you know, for several months now. I understand there's, you know, 400 additional teachers within the system, many more support staff. So it's not like they haven't, you know, had the ability to go and do that hiring before. They have already been doing that, and then how they operationalize those resources, you know, they're doing that at the individual school level.
Okay, and just so I'm perfectly clear on the role of the center, the center provides simply support for teachers. Does it remove any students from a teacher's roll call in terms of their daily instruction?
Well, and I think that these circumstances will change over time. At this point in time, we're focused on building the repository and the online portal, as well as supporting teachers first and foremost. There will be learning materials and resources that are developed so that students can learn from home with these learning supports that will be packaged in a way that will be project-based or inquiry-based learning as a best practice that's emerging. So it's not intended necessarily at this point in time to be pulling kids out of the classrooms per se, but to really find a way of supporting the teachers in building up their toolkit and also the resources that are there for them. So that's our first priority with establishing the remote learning support center.
Thanks, everyone. And this concludes today's media briefing.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of the day.